for his show. Joel Friday's show is happening shortly here, guys. It is 9 a.m. here in Los Angeles. And yes, we are going live on YouTube and I presume Rumble and D Live. Shout out to the D Live crew and the Facebook crew, I think. Let me double check that Facebook is going. Kick, X, Twitter, and other places. Thank you guys for joining me. Some of you guys are on hold. You can call in 1-888-775-3773. Let me kick on my IG, my Instagram, because I like to go live on IG. I don't get a lot of people maybe tune in. Some of them comment. What will we cover today? It'll be just a loosey-goosey Hake report show, okay? We have some fun music to play for you guys. Some mess going on in the world. O.J. Simpson, rest in peace, according to reports. He died at the tender age of, what was it, 74 or 76? 76. Gone too soon. That's pretty young. It's not the youngest that getting up there in age people die, but that's pretty young. After a quote-unquote battle with cancer. I'm shaking my head. He was written about, or JLP wrote about him in The Antidote. His father became like a cross-dresser in the Bay Area at the Castro District and left to be a homosexual. And he later died of AIDS when OJ was in his like 40s, I think. Terrible. What a mess. So he's gone. I saw some of the chats in your guys' chats in the live chat of the J.C. Lee Peterson show when JLP announced it and Hake mentioned it in Hake News. That he's gone to be back with, what's his wife's name? The woman who died? Whom he allegedly, they say he killed. Nicole. He and Nicole are back together. But that's not true. Because Jesus said in heaven, he's gone to be with the Lord, you can say. OJ has gone to be with the Lord. Or who knows? You're neither married nor given in marriage. So you're not going to be with a woman for eternity, you know? Get it right. It's not, a woman is not, has nothing to do with eternity with you. That's just on earth. It says, till death do us part, though the old wedding vows that barely anybody keeps. I don't know. Anyway. So we'll have a fun show, guys. Your calls and your super chats, appreciate them. Some of them have already come in. Talk a little bit about the news and some cultural stuff going on in the world. But anyway, guys, let's get right on with the show!
1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, it's the Hake Report. The Hake Report. La, la, la.
How you guys doing? I am fine. I have my I Love Boomers t-shirt. Get your mind out of the gutter, you white lion. Black on the inside, white lion. He thought it said something else, or he pretends to have thought so. Strong voice today, Hake. Thank you. Thank you very much. Some of you guys are bitter about what happened to Nicole Simpson. Nicole Brown Simpson, was that her maiden name? Yeah, you can get your t-shirt, your I Love Boomers t-shirt. It's a size medium, I don't know. I need to walk off those pounds. I forgot that I said something like that. Shout out to Bibby. He was in the snake pit over in the Anchor Baby chat. Is Anchor Baby's chat a snake pit as well? The Hake Report dot creator-spring.com. Creator, C-R-E-A-T-O-R hyphen, is that little dash thing? Spring.com. The Hake Report dot creator-spring.com. It used to be teespring.com/stores/The Hake Report. I'm not bitter. Nice. Good. Not good. It's good not to be bitter. Because boomers catch all kinds of hatred. Boomers get poo-pooed by both the liberals and the young Zoomers, conservatives, and millennials. They blame them for squandering the wealth. They had it so easy, but they were raised by people who raised them to be like that, basically. And, you know, they were also very influenced by a pretty effective propaganda machine, apparently. Pretty effective propaganda machine that turned MLK into a hero. That's a pretty effective propaganda machine. Pretty subversive, if you ask me. Better Not Bitter is a Bond t-shirt, by the way, guys. Rebuildingtheman.com/stores. Okay, so everyone hates boomers, and you gotta stop hating boomers because the boomers are just like you. You become what you hate. So, Hake has already become a boomer. Anyway, so yes, love the boomers. Don't be like, okay, boomer. They're not liberal enough for the young, dumb liberal extremists, and they're not, obviously not conservative enough for God or anybody else. So anyway, shout out to the boomers. We love them, if we love anybody. I want the yellow shirt, though. Yeah, this is like a golden yellow, and it's 100% cotton, and I suggest maybe getting a size larger if you're one of those people who, like, is still stuck in the 2010s or 2005s. And wears shirts that are, like, supposed to fit you. What a mess. You know, let me start right off with a call or two here, guys. You can call in 1-888-775-3773. Joe in Phoenix, Arizona is on the line. How are you doing, Joe?
Good morning, James. All righty.
Morning.
So, I did not vote for Biden.
Good. Yeah.
Art was saying that.
Yes, Art.
I sure as heck didn't vote for Trump.
Okay. Yeah, Art from Ohio called yesterday thinking that you may have voted for Biden. And did you hear me say I didn't know? Because I didn't know if you voted for him. I think you voted for Obama twice. Was that accurate?
I voted for Obama twice.
Yeah.
And I want to explain to you why.
Let that sink in. A black conservative voted for Obama twice. And why?
So, I told you that I have worked on a few committees with McCain, right?
Yeah, that's right. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And he and I did not get along.
So he knew you?
Yes, I worked with him personally.
Okay.
The first committee I was on, it was a congressional committee, to increase trade and technology sharing between Arizona and some East African countries because we have similar climate.
Nice.
Yeah. And, you know, he was the sponsor of the committee, and I was elected to be one of the leaders. And, me being who I am, I started working immediately and getting things done. And
right on. Your white side coming in strong.
Yeah, okay. And he didn't like that I was talking to some of the politicians from East African countries. And he tried to call me out.
Why
in
not?
A meeting.
Like he felt like you were insubordinating him, like going ahead of him?
How dare you go over my head?
Okay. You know? All right.
I said, I'm not going over here. I'm just getting stuff done. So yeah. Now we're raising our voices to each other in a committee meeting in public.
Sounds like you and Hake raising our voices at each other in public.
Yeah. So that's why I could not vote for McCain against Obama in the first election.
Was it personal when you didn't vote
Absolutely.
For McCain?
Absolutely.
Okay,
100%, yeah.
Oh, so it wasn't at all on a principle. Like, this guy is not a humble man who will listen to good advice or whatever. It wasn't anything like that?
He was trying to chastise me like I was one of his kids. That's not going to fly for me at all, especially in public. You're not going to humiliate me in public, and I'm going to fire back, of course. I don't care who you are.
Dang.
Now, I respected his service for sure, but don't try to, you know, talk down to me, especially in public. Not going to happen.
What service was that you respected?
His military service.
What did he... Because a lot of people, quote-unquote, serve in the military, and, you know, they don't get any reprimands or something like that. But what did, do you know if he did anything good while being in the so-called service?
I don't know his service record in detail. I do know he survived the Hanoi Hilton. That took a whole lot of guts and determination and grit.
Hanoi Hilton. Okay, so Hanoi Hilton is a place where in Vietnam they had
POW
prisoners of war, and they would torture them. And so they tortured him.
Correct.
And how do you know that it took... He was tortured and he survived. What do you mean it took guts? How did he conduct himself that it took guts to... Because you can survive a torture and be a baby about it, or you can be gutsy about it. What's that?
I don't think you survive torture and be a baby, Jack.
I don't know. I mean, a baby was... Well, I'm talking about, like, a beta. Betas survive torture. I mean, betas... People were... There's rumors that he sang like a bird and like gave them information, but I don't know. I don't believe that or disbelieve it. I don't care. But being tortured itself doesn't mean that it took guts, you know, because you can be tortured and you, I don't think just because you're crying about it doesn't mean you're going to die. Doesn't mean you're not going to survive.
I don't know about all that, James. All I know is that he tried to condescend to me. And,
yeah.
You know, talk down to me, so we did not get along.
Right, yeah. I don't mind that McCain lost. I don't mind that, even though I did vote for him, I wasn't a fan of his. I voted for him knowing full well he yelled at Joe from Phoenix. No, I'm kidding. that's why I voted for him. But, I did not appreciate Obama at all. Except that he was something new. He was something new, and I was like, oh, something new. You know, a little excitement there. But I voted for Romney both times, actually. And I voted for McCain, so blah, blah, blah. Anyway. So,
Obama.
Yeah, go ahead.
Obamaphones. I know you've talked about Obamaphones being a form of socialism, yeah?
Probably, yeah.
Okay. James, do you know how Lifeline Assistance is funded?
Lifeline Assistance?
That's what most people call Obamaphones. That's the program.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
But it's not funded by tax dollars. So by definition, it can't be socialism.
What's it funded? By what is it funded?
It's funded by fees charged by the telecom company, by law written by Ronald Reagan.
So Ronald Reagan was a socialist.
Ronald Reagan created the Lifeline Assistance Plan to help bring steady phone service to rural, poor communities, mostly white communities, actually, during his time.
Now, Ronald Reagan and Donald Trump both have socialist-type things that they do. I'm resisting saying socialistic. Mm. And, but they were socialists for Christ, maybe.
But, very good, huh?
Because that still is socialism, man. If you are forcing a company to fund, making a law, forcing a company to subsidize people getting free phones, poor whatever, poor lamos, whether they're white or whatever, no, I don't know, whatever, to get free phones, that is socialism. It doesn't matter if it's, because that's basically a tax, not through the government, but through the companies, on the people who have to give to the people who have not.
Okay, my point is that, yeah, one, Obama didn't create that program, and it's not funded by tax dollars. So, two, blame that on Obama is just insane.
I'm not big on the Obama phone thing. That's more of a JLP thing. But Jesus was a socialist. Oh, no, that's kidding. But Obamacare was a socialist thing, and the Obama phones.
How? I'm sorry. Yeah. How is Obamacare socialist?
Forcing everybody to buy something that they don't necessarily want, meddling and forcing companies to do stuff that they shouldn't have to do. They should be allowed to discriminate based on pre-existing conditions, especially nowadays with the people so out of control. It's
Are seatbelt laws socialist, James?
Maybe so.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah, because I remember being a kid. I don't know if you remember anybody complaining about seatbelt laws, but I remember people complaining about seatbelt laws when I was a kid. The Gen Xers and the Boomers were complaining about them.
It was. I remember not wearing a seatbelt as a small kid, sure.
Yeah, and do you remember anybody complaining about the overreach aspect of it, or these seatbelt laws?
I remember folks being happy when insurance rates came down because seatbelt laws came in.
Okay, but you don't remember them complaining about it?
I'm sure some people complained about being forced to wear a seatbelt, sure.
Yeah, and it's interesting. But Obamacare is a completely different thing from seatbelt laws. I mean, one may be worse than the other, and I think that's the case with Obamacare.
Obamacare, or the ACA, we should say, forced people to get insurance because you and I, as tax-paying citizens, were paying for the people who went to urgent care with no insurance.
Right.
So they were forcing them to be responsible.
No, the way that you force them to be responsible is you put them in debtor's prison and put them into slavery until they work off their debt to the
hospitals.
That's
illegal, James. Can't do that.
Well, maybe we should change the laws to be more just rather than more socialist and mama.
Well, thank goodness you're not a lawyer. All right.
Well,
one last thing, so you don't hang up on me. The guy from yesterday who watched the Alex Jones documentary, they didn't focus on Adam Lanza because Adam Lanza is dead. He already paid the ultimate price for his violent, terrible crimes.
But isn't it more interesting and isn't it more instructive to learn about the life of the young man, and we use the term man loosely, who did it, so that we can learn and realize that we need to return to families and fathers and not this liberalism and divorce and pills for your brain because you got mental issues and stuff like that.
Now, see, James, there you and I agree 100%. We can't find common ground and not yell at each other.
Nice.
I agree with what you said 100% there.
Nice. So you're not for this gun control crap. Sorry, kids.
No, I own guns. I'm a Second Amendment person for sure. So I do not want government overreaching into gun control. Absolutely not. Sensible good gun control, I'm fine with. I don't think folks need, you know, huge magazines and weapons of war, but
I think they
beyond that. Really?
Yeah, in that, big magazines. I mean, the gangsters and cartels and those people have those awesome magazine things and weapons of war. Why not the people? Especially the good people.
Law enforcement should have it, but I don't think anyone, especially criminals, should be having that. But anyway.
Right. The criminals are the ones who get them more even than the law enforcement, maybe.
Well, see, now we agree again. We're finding all kinds of common ground.
So then these laws that are outlawing the, because laws are for the, laws nowadays are more for the law abiding than for the people who are going to skirt the law, if that's the right word for it.
I understand what you're saying there. But
yeah.
You know what? Let's end while we're still being pleasant to each other.
You tired of fighting? Now, let me ask you last quick question. You seem to feel the need to defend your reputation or honor from these people who say these things about you. I guess I have two last questions. And that seems like a flaw. That seems like a flaw because they control you then. Because they trigger something in you and you feel the need to defend your honor against people whom you don't even really respect anyway. Like, I mean, you somewhat respect people, but you shouldn't...
Is it a question, James?
It's more of a comment. Am I wrong that you have this ego need to defend yourself and your reputation?
I wouldn't say defend. I'm just clarifying. When folks are speculating about, that's all.
My second question or comment, what was it? I forget what it was. But I want to remember what it was. Oh, yes. You didn't hear when I corrected the record when that guy said those things. A guy said some dirty things about you, right? This guy, Glenn.
Correct.
And you didn't hear him take it back, and you didn't hear me... very mildly and lightly, but decidedly, multiple times, corrected him on saying those things. I'm like, I don't want to get into that.
Yesterday.
Oh, you went back?
The first time I was listening to it, I was distracted and wasn't really listening. So, no, I didn't hear it. But I did go back to it. You said that yesterday, and I did hear you do that, yes.
And you heard him take it back and actually wish you well.
I did, yes.
And he took it back twice. He said, I take that back. I was wrong.
I did. He had some venom when he first said it, but he did take it back. Yeah.
Yeah. He admitted that he was angry listening to you, and he had to hang up listening to you because he was so mad. And that's interesting that happens. People do that with Maze too, my favorite caller. But my point in bringing that up is there's stuff that you miss that you don't hear, but you hear this stuff that. Pricks the ego or is nasty sounding against you, right?
You're reading too much into it, James.
No, listen to this. Listen to this. You may not be...
because you're...
No, but hold on. But let me just make this comment. It may be true, it may not be true. That's the same thing that's happening with the JLP show. You hear him saying most blacks are R-worded, etarded, Ray, right? And you don't hear him speaking the love... that goes with that truth.
I'm not going to talk about JLP because I know you get very sensitive about that. I'll leave that alone. But the reason I missed that the first time on the call is because I think I told you that I rescue huskies. And my latest husky has not been spayed yet, and she's going through heat and causing all kinds of problems with my other two dogs. So that's why I was distracted the first time I was listening to that call. That's all.
All right.
That's all it was.
All right. Well, I appreciate it, Joe in Phoenix. Take care, man.
All right, man. Have a good day.
Bye. Nice. David in Ocala, Florida is on the line here. David, what's up over in Ocala for you?
It's raining like cats and dogs, man.
Oh, really? It's supposed to be raining.
Bad.
It's going to be raining here over the weekend again.
I thought it never rained in Southern California.
Oh, no. It rains here. I love the rain. I like it.
Hey, I normally don't call in back-to-back days. You know, I give you time off. I appreciate you taking my call because I wanted to talk about OJ.
Nice.
And
rest in
peace.
Yeah,
go ahead. I'm sorry.
I said rest in peace. We just got word that he died.
Yeah, I don't think he's resting in peace, but anyway.
Oh, whoa. You said, but anyway. You can't just throw out a bomb like that and say, but anyway. You don't think he was a Christian? You don't think he went to be with the Lord?
I really can't judge him, but
it sounds like you flippantly did it before just now. You'd say no?
Yeah, maybe I did. Well, you know, the Word of God says you'll know them by their fruits, and he really didn't have much fruit, did he? Okay.
Did you hear or see anything from him in the last 30 years, 25 years, whenever?
Well, he got arrested and got put in jail on, like, the anniversary of the murder, man, you know, for 13 years for trying to sell that stuff out in Vegas or get his stuff back. You know,
yeah, he tried to get his stuff back. But getting arrested and going to jail isn't necessarily meaning you're going to H.E. Double Toothpicks.
Well, if you slit your, you know, if you slice your wife up and her boyfriend up, if he did do it, he's finished.
But
he's done.
Wait. Murderers, they're murderers can go to heaven after they do a murder sometimes.
Well, you said if he did it, but they
acquitted him.
Okay. Well, this is why I was calling you, because this is why I believe that why they acquitted him.
Okay.
That's why I wanted to call. Because
great.
Y'all live there and y'all experience this. I really truly believe that the main reason why that jury found him not guilty was because of the riots from Rodney King, and they knew that if they convicted him, that they would burn that y'all city down. If you thought the Rodney King riots were going to be bad, those OJ riots would have been twice as bad.
You think so?
What do you think about that?
I don't think that that's necessarily the. I don't think that's the case. I don't think so, because the blacks weren't all. I didn't hear about the blacks being all that hyped about it as much as they were about Rodney King, because Rodney King, they witnessed him getting beaten. And OJ, yeah, I get that there were a lot of blacks who thought, oh, he's just going after him because he's black.
Right.
But there was no...
You were young,
there was no.
Weren't you? I mean, you were...
I was in high school.
12 or 13?
No, I was in high school. I think I was... What was it, 1995?
Or 4, something like that. Yeah, so...
Yeah, because yeah. I remember seeing the chase, right? Was it a slow speed chase?
The Bronco chase.
Yeah, and I feel like I saw that on the TV in my science class freshman year of high school,
okay.
And so yeah, that's actually when I became aware of O.J. Simpson.
Mm-hmm. Well, he might not
or
be
maybe
guilty.
That was the,
I mean,
maybe that was the trial. I don't know. But anyway.
He might not be guilty. I mean, I think we spoke before. There was a guy named Clay Rogers that said his brother, the serial killer, Glenn Rogers, knocked her off.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
So he might not have did it.
Now, if he did, like, mm-hmm. I don't know or care. I'm not interested. But if he did, that would be a case of black, because weren't there blacks on the jury?
Oh, I'm sure there was. Uh-huh.
Blacks are good at, I wanted to make this point, jury nullification. Blacks are good at jury nullification because they don't know or care about the facts or the law. I'm just spouting
they
this
just
off
hate
because
whitey. They just
this is my impression.
Whitey.
This is my impression. The impression that I get from black people is that the first time I served jury duty, this older black lady said, "I'm a Christian. We're not supposed to judge, and so I don't believe in doing this because we're not supposed to judge." I'm like thinking to myself. I think that she's no. She told me that. This is before
I know, they let her out. They didn't.
Oh,
didn't
I don't know. I didn't go into. I don't remember. I was probably let out of the room too because I answered some question that some lawyer asked, and then I was all proud of myself that they answered the question correctly. And plus, I was probably dressed in my like cross country T-shirt and shorts and something dumb like that. But and so the you know how they do the peremptory challenges or whatever. The lawyers say, "Oh, please let this guy off, juror number 4." You're out of here, Hake. But anyway, my impression is that blacks don't care. They'll just go based on what they think and not what on... They're not led by the facts. They're led by their prejudice. So if they're prejudiced in favor of OJ, they're going to say not guilty no matter what.
Yeah.
That's what my impression is. I could be completely wrong, blacks, but I don't think so.
I can see that. You know, I got called all the way deep into the jury thing one time.
Yeah.
And the way I got out, it was a kid that got busted for possession of marijuana.
Yeah.
And the way I got out of it was I told him I didn't feel right judging somebody on something that I that I used to do.
Because
I wanted to leave. I didn't want to go into the court case. You know, I'm going to get back to work.
Yeah.
So they let me out. But, hey, since Joe called about McCain, I just wanted to say McCain was a rhino. And the only reason why he got really that recognition I feel that he got was because he was a prisoner in that Vietnam War, that joke of a war that they, you know, put my daddy in and many thousands of men that had to go over there and all the thousands of men that lost their lives. And, you know, God bless him for being a prisoner of war and what he had to go through. But he couldn't close some open face sandwich, that guy McCain. He was weaker than water. You like that?
Yeah, that's funny. So your dad, your father, your daddy, as you said, had to go. I guess that would have been a draft, huh? Was he drafted into the war?
Yeah, he got drafted. He was there in 69 and 70. He was in the 9th Infantry, man, in the Army.
Uh-huh.
And he got a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star.
Purple Heart means injured, right?
Yeah, he got injured. Yeah, he got shot.
Wounded. Yeah. And then what's Bronze Star?
For being heroic, he ran across like 50-yard field to set up fire to protect his battalion.
That's awesome, man. That's cool. Right on.
Yeah, what's really awesome is Forrest Gump, in the movie Forrest Gump, when Forrest Gump gets into Vietnam, it's the 9th Infantry. That's the same outfit that my father wore, the same patch that he had. It was really cool. I noticed that. But hey, one more thing. I want to
talk McCain a little bit more because you brought this up. McCain, I don't think that's the only reason that he was quote unquote successful. The main reason why he was successful, that was the excuse. They're like, oh, he's a hero. He's a war hero.
Right.
The main reason he was successful, though, was on the worldly sense, was that he went along with the world. He was an establishment rhino. The media loved him because the media was liberal, and he was pretending to be a Republican, but he was really a liberal. And so he would go against the Republicans, and they called him a maverick for that. And I don't think of that as being a maverick when you're supporting evil against what's right. Like, I could see going against the Republican Party when they're wrong, but he went against them when they were where they were right, or he went even worse wrong than they were. Let's say the Republican Party was wrong, but he went even worse wrong, I think. That was my impression of him.
Mm-hmm.
A Trump hater, definitely. And he was like you said, he was weak. Definitely on the border. He was for like amnesty and all kinds of mess, which was against what the people wanted.
Right. So, well, they deliberately, the Democrats.
So you said he wasn't able to close an open face sandwich. What do you mean? Like, was there stuff that he was trying to pass but he couldn't?
No, he's just weak. I mean, could you imagine that dude trying to pick up a chick at a, you know? I mean, that's what I mean.
That was lame when the old lady said, "I'm scared about Obama. He's an Arab." She called him an Arab because she was trying to say he's Muslim. And he's like, no, ma'am. He's a good American Christian man, and I think he would be a great president. And they started to boo him, but I think I'd be a lot better a president. So he kissed up to Obama and kissed up to the fake race, anti-racism, anti-prejudice stuff. Who would want a person named Obama to be the American president? It doesn't even make sense. But he kissed up to that anti-prejudice stuff.
Right, his real name is Barry Sotero anyway.
Right, yeah, Sotero was his stepfather's name, huh?
I guess.
The Muslim.
The bottom line is he ain't Barack Obama. You got what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. He was all Americanized when it suited him, and then he became all ethnic when it became in to be ethnic.
Mm-hmm.
Obama. What a lame-o.
Obama.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey.
Real quick.
Let me ask you a question, man. Okay. Because I want your advice on this, okay? I told you like 39 years ago, almost on July the 4th, I had these three kids try to kill me in a car one time. I think I told you about that. Well, one of the main person contacted me on Facebook yesterday to tell me he was sorry. He was just a kid, and that basically I hope I can forgive him.
Uh-huh.
I can't believe it.
Wow.
This is the last person in the world that I would think would reach out to me.
Wow. Right on, man. So what advice did you want?
Well, that particular thing's been part of my anger issues for a long time. So I told this gentleman, I told him, you need to call me. It was late at night last night. He said, I got to go to bed. I got to get up at 4 a.m.
Yeah.
But I want him to call me because I want to talk to him about it. And hopefully this will help me get over this thing after all these years, you know.
Maybe so. It might be like, kind of eye-opening. You might start to relate to him a little bit. But you want to get over that with or without the quote-unquote closure of talking to the person who wronged you. Because I understand. You were probably set up to be a hate-filled, resentful person from childhood, and these people were just the excuse. It's kind of like blacks hating whites. Blacks don't really hate whites. They are just brainwashed into this hatred of whites. But the root of it is the hatred that started with them from the home, from long before they ever met a white.
Yeah, well, that's not the case here. I was taken to the edge of almost dying, man, and that's why I'm very like...
But still, the same thing.
Yeah. All right. Well, listen, I appreciate you taking my call. I don't want to go deep
call into
this.
JLP. Call into JLP on this, or feel free to call in to the bond and set up a counseling appointment if you're so inclined.
Well, what I'll do.
Oh, we can
talk
about this another day too.
Yeah. I'll talk to the guy and then I'll let you know what happens. Man, you have a great day. And remember, like I said, I really feel like they made OJ not guilty so they wouldn't, you know, people wouldn't go crazy.
Yeah.
Think about that and see what you think. Anyway, y'all have a great day, man. It's raining hard here. I'm about to lose you. Okay?
Take care. All right. Bye. All right. Take care, man. I hung up on him real quick. Man. We're plowing through calls, guys. There was some stuff that I wanted to get to before I get back to calls. Hang tight, callers. Let's see here. Let's talk about these New York City women getting punched real briefly. I'll try to be brief. I saw this video on News Nation. Dan Abrams interviewed this gal. Multiple NYC women claim they were randomly sucker punched in New York City. And he interviewed one woman. About it, named Sterling Quinn, who was a victim, allegedly, of a sucker punching in New York City. But her sucker punching was 2 years ago. This has been going on a long time. The news catches up with stuff late. Oftentimes. They catch up with stuff late. Oh, there's a trend of Prius is getting their catalytic converters stolen, and you hear about it 2 or 3 years after it's been happening to your friends like multiple times. Just kidding, I don't have any friends who have Priuses. But you know, you hear about it happening, or you hear these loud sound like these huge motorcycles that are Harley Davidson type things. Oh, loud. But this woman, was walking to the gym around a corner of this particular cross street. And she looks like she still has a fat lip from it 2 years later. This gal. But she was looking down on her phone, getting ready to go to the gym. And you know how some of these people look down at their phone to prepare something? Maybe they have to open up some app or something like that for their gym to scan the code and get in or something. She was doing something like that. And this guy on his bike had something wrapped around his fist, and she didn't say the race. So we don't know the race necessarily. But we know whom we have seen more frequently than not on video doing it. Oh, but the biker gangs do it too, Joe, from Phoenix. Just as much. I don't think so. Punched her. Stunned her. And she's all, hey, come back, fight me! Because she had, like, pepper spray. She was stunned. And nobody helped her. Except one, maybe like a 19-year-old girl helped her get up. New Yorkers. Not very neighborly. Not very Christian. Necessarily. But yeah, it's become a thing. And I bet you, I don't know, but I bet you that there are fakers going on TikTok just to hop on the trend. Oh, I was punched. Terrible. But be alert. Don't be looking at your phone in public when you're out and about. Be alert. The wild animals, when I go out, I used to drive out to Marshall Canyon, take a jog or a bike ride in Marshall Canyon in the hills over in like Laverne area out east of LA. And they said, careful, there are mountain lions, also known as cougars, who prey on the small and the unsuspecting, the stragglers. So if you're in a group, don't be straggling behind, because the predators, super predators, no conscience, no empathy, based, based Hillary Clinton, will snatch ya, get ya. Watch out. Be careful. And she's all, nobody cares about women, this gal said. Ladies, you voted for this more often than not. You voted for the liberalism, for the feel sorry for criminals. Feel sorry for these people. Because they get, what did I tell you last week, I think? They get out on like a, first of all, they don't even catch most of these people. Most crimes, they're getting away with it. They're getting away with it. Did you know that they don't catch people, most criminals? Especially in high crime areas, also known as black areas or Hispanic. And a lot of the Asians and whites know, are slick too. They know how to get away with crimes sometimes. So, they're getting away with it, or they're getting misdemeanors. I told you last week about this case where this guy got assaulted twice in two different occasions. Don't know what's wrong with this guy. He's getting assaulted on two different occasions. That sounds more than just bad luck. It sounds like bad practices. But maybe I'm wrong. But he got severely injured the second time. And he had to go to, like, emergency surgery. And the first time, they didn't even file a report. The police didn't even file a report. So you say, oh, crime is going down? I don't necessarily believe that. Because maybe we had a tougher anti-crime, more manly, more high testosterone, both criminals and cops, back in the 80s, 90s. And we went hard on crime. And now we're going soft on crime, and we're like, oh, we want the city to be... the police are overwhelmed. We have an anti-police thing. A lot of the police are quitting. They see that it's anti-white. They see it's anti-cop. The cops are getting arrested or charged sometimes for doing their jobs. So they don't want to do their jobs. They're not going to file a report. They're busy. They're overwhelmed. And so I don't think that crime is going down. Why are you shaking your head at me or facepalming me, rockstar novelist? These ladies voted for this stuff. They're weak with the evil and strong against the good. That's what I say anyway. But and plus, that's not a natural hair. But it's, you know, it's mildly attractive. So that's your New York City women getting punched. Speaking of New York women, Hillary Clinton. This was funny, and I wanted to get to it. Hillary Clinton said, "Get over yourselves." This is like a week ago. Get over yourself. I saw this from Reddit and elsewhere. Hillary Clinton tells an apathetic voters, people who are have apathy, meaning they don't care. People like Hake, who are upset about another Biden and Trump match, a rematch. Get over. She's looking a little haggard there. Nice hair, but looking kind of like Hake. With my bags under my eyes like Hillary Clinton. Get over yourself. Isn't that amusing? Hillary Clinton telling people to get over yourself. You want the first woman president? A woman president. Hillary Clinton can't, sore loser. People say Trump is a sore loser. Trump doesn't have the spirit of a sore loser. It's my impression. Trump's a complainer. He complains for Christ, or he complains like a man. He complains out of like sort of a campaigning spirit because he speaks what the people are thinking too, because he's speaking the plain truth that normal people can see too. Or it helps awaken the normal people's minds and opens them up to some true things, true statements. Hillary looks like the Crypt Keeper. I've never seen that show. I think, is that from Goosebumps or something? Or she's a horrific monster. But who looked like the Crypt Keeper, because I searched it on this totally useless website, Google. You don't look haggard, hey? Thank you, DNK127. But I know, but I definitely, when I don't get my beauty sleep, or my handsome sleep, I should call it, I get bags under my eyes. I remember years ago, my former coworker was like, "Sweet lifestyle choice, bro. You got bags under your eyes. You're not getting sleep. You're drinking Monsters and rock stars. Sweet lifestyle choice, bro." Get over yourself is a narcissist way of telling someone they don't matter. But they don't matter. But also, she's all full of herself, seemingly. She's supposedly a Christian. A Methodist. Is she a United Methodist? It's not Goosebumps? Is it something else? The Crypt Keeper? What's the Crypt Keeper from? Blur the picture, Hake. Censor it. I told the Hispanics to get over themselves. Remember, I told you guys that in Hake News, because the Hispanics, and I'll get back to calls, guys. Thank you for bearing with me, callers. Hang tight. These crying Hispanics, 40%. I guess I'm done with Hillary. Thank you, Hassan. Hillary says get over yourself, and Hake says get over yourself too. We're twins. She sort of looks like my mom. If my mom were nasty and fat and full of herself, politically speaking, politically power hungry type speaking. Anyway, 40% of Hispanic and Latino / A professionals. This is from Commie Nonsense Network, okay? CNN, morning updates. Latino / A, it's Latino. It's Latino. Latino includes Latinos and Latinas. Duh! Stupid inclusive CNN. Don't say stupid, kids. And don't be full of animus, kids. Professionals, quote unquote, in the corporate America claim they feel it necessary to change aspects of themselves. They think it's them, their identity, to succeed at work, per this new study. What study? Among the more than 2,300 Hispanic professionals surveyed, many say they feel stereotyped, overlooked, and underappreciated. Who doesn't feel underappreciated sometimes at their jobs? What egotistical person doesn't feel underappreciated at their jobs? Give me a break. If you're paid, that's all you need. oh, it's a hostile work environment. Well, stop feeling hostile. Most of the time, that stuff is in your own evil heart. If you took it with a smile, five shots couldn't drop me, I took it and smiled, then you'd be fine. I cracked. Sometimes they're even encouraged to assimilate to office norms. Everybody has to assimilate to whatever the norms are of the office. Ooh, and they act like assimilation is like this bad thing. That's how badly they hate the whites, basically, is what you're telling me. At least Commie Nonsense is telling me this. It's an article by Jean Sahadi. Saadi. What survey? Who did this survey? The study, More Than a Monolith, The Advancement of Hispanic and Latino / A Talent. The nonprofit COQUAL, COQUAL, which has a female CEO, I presume it's female, Lanaya Irvin. Our findings illuminate hurdles Hispanic and Latino professionals face, including undue pressure to mask their authentic selves. Authentic means phony selves, means phony mama spirit attachment to this la raza, this like dumb identity. Just like when the transgenders or the LGBTs, they think they're being their authentic selves. Authentic is a liberal word. And it means the opposite of what it actually, the dictionary definition, it's the opposite of that. Phony. Which this think tank, nonprofit think tank, COQUAL, seeks to address bias and uncover barriers to advancement for underrepresented populations in the workplace.
Two.
That's what I say to that. Spit in my spittoon. Hat tip to my Latino friend, too. Is Madman a Latino? Hispanic? I think Madman sent this to me, my spittoon, back when I was out sick. James is a caller from New York who's been on hold forever. James, thank you for calling and holding there, man. How you doing?
Hey, Hake. Hey. I wanted to touch on a couple topics, but before I heard you say that Jesus was a socialist, and I've heard a lot of people say that, whether jokingly or serious.
I was reading the chat. I wasn't agreeing with it, just so you know, just to clear it up.
Oh, okay.
But go ahead.
I just wanted to ask you, even if someone thought he was a socialist, because he never forced anyone to, you know, care about the poor. He always made it as a choice, so... How could you, is that included as like a socialist thing? Is if you, you know,
that's
if
right.
It's offered by choice, it's not forced upon nobody. They can choose to help the poor or help the sick or whatever. But
exactly.
It's not like he wrote it in the Bible that you have to do it. You know,
right.
I never heard that.
They do say true religion that God our Father accepts as pure and holy is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. And most of those liberals none of us keep ourselves from being polluted by the world. And then they're not actually looking after orphans and widows. They're looking after people who are not orphans and widows. They're making, encouraging people to become orphans and widows by increasing the crime. You're right. And when you're saying by force, you're talking about the government doing it, rather than people freely giving as the spirit leads, because there were times not to give stuff to the poor. At times, they were supposed to do stuff like the woman who gave the perfume. I've mentioned this story a few times. She poured perfume on Jesus's feet and like cried her tears on his feet and dried it with her hair. I guess that was sanitary. And Jesus addressed the grumblers, the hypocrites, who were like, this should have been given to the poor. And he's like, the poor you will always have with you. You will not always have me. Mm-hmm. So You're not always supposed to be giving to the poor. And there aren't any poor in America. But you're right. And this socialism stuff is anti. They just subvert Christianity. I guess that there were some supposedly Christian communist countries. But that was not very Christian, that communism. It was a subversion.
Mm. Yeah, that's exactly what I was feeling on it, too.
Yeah.
The second thing, because the topic is fresh, and I think this is the last thing I could think about for the topic. But we were talking the other day about the kid's parents, or you know, being charged with the crime of a kid or whatever. I was really like thinking about it. I'm like, okay, like does this make sense? Because I heard a lot of people, you know, agreeing with Joel or agreeing with that way of thinking that the parents should be held responsible. And I was thinking, in that sense, what responsibility should be held on to God for creating the devil? Like, and I'm not saying that because I want God to be responsible, but if we're talking about like parents who create the child, who you know, and it comes in and.
Oh, you're cutting out, James, in New York.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was thinking about
you
like,
have to stay in a place with good connection, good signal.
Oh, am I better now or no?
Yeah, you're better now, I guess. I'm not sure what's going on.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah.
But could we hold? Because God created the devil, right? Am I wrong for saying that? I assume God created the devil, right?
I think that's fair. Whatever. Yeah.
Okay. Does that mean that God should be held accountable for all the evil the devil like commits or imbues into people as well? Should we hold God accountable?
Who's going to hold God accountable for what God does?
I don't mean like literally, but you know. Like,
but I know, but that's what the atheists think, because they think that they know better than God. They think that they know what's good and evil, and they're just based on their own fallen state emotions. They're evil people. Uh-huh. Blind evil people think that they know better than God how to run the world.
Yeah, and that's what I think about.
Make me like, want to cuss.
Yeah, like, and that's what I was thinking about to go against the argument that the parents should be held against accountable for the actions of their children, because it's like how can you? Like,
well, Joel Friday's case, I kept on hearing him say, in this specific case, because they missed the mm-hmm. signs. And I agree that they should have caught on, but, and like, taken the gun away and stuff like that. But mm-hmm. that's not the law has no business saying that. That's a common mm-hmm. sense thing. And nowadays, people don't have common sense. And now you're going to make people get paranoid. And that's not just to throw them in jail for something that they didn't do. It's just like, it's like finding AJ, my competitor, not Gallardo, but AJ, my competitor, a $1.5 billion for something that somebody else harassing, so-called families of victims of Sandy Hook shooting. That doesn't make any sense.
I was shocked that the parents didn't get have to pay the actual lawsuit fine. I feel like it would be more justified for the parents to pay that than him.
Yeah, because the parents are... Indeed. Yeah, go ahead.
The last question I have, only because it's like Bible Thumper Thursday.
Bible Thumper Thursday is for the JLP show.
Oh, okay. But
yeah, I don't Bible thump. But go ahead. But what's your real fast? Since you brought it up, made me curious.
Did God make the universe so vast and infinite so He can be as far away from us as possible?
Is that a joke?
No, I'm literally asking.
Oh.
Because God's never made Himself like known to anyone directly, you know. I guess from the stories I've heard, like the last time He made Himself known to man was like Adam and Eve, and then through Jesus, and when Jesus came.
Oh, but yeah, like, you were raised sort of a foster kid, Catholic charities kid, so you don't know anything about Christianity, huh?
Yeah. Oh,
okay.
No.
Yeah, you're fresh. Okay. No, I don't think so. I mean, I don't think that he physically wants to be far or. I heard that God is everywhere. I don't know if that's true, but I heard that he's everywhere.
Oh yeah, that makes sense.
Omnipresent.
Okay, no,
or maybe that just means he's always present. He's always in the present. I don't know. They made all these omni words up. Omniscient, omnipotent. And I don't know if those are, I think those are intellectual words that they made up. I don't even know if the Bible even says stuff like that. But no, I don't think so. I think he just made it because it's so awesome and cool and space is real and straight, morally straight anyway. I'm saying that to oppose the people who say that space is fake and not morally straight. I don't know if you're familiar with those people.
Yeah.
But I think he just made it because it's awesome. It's cool.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I guess that sounded like...
And I could be completely wrong for the reasoning God had.
Got it.
So, yeah.
All right. Thanks, Jake. I appreciate your time, man.
Yeah, appreciate you. Bye. Oh, man, I'm past the top of the hour, guys. It is... I'm chuckling at music. Oh, Petra Thursday. And then I'll get back to calls. Petra Thursday is coming up, guys. And it's coming up right now. Coming at you fast. It hasn't been Petra music for a while. It's Christian. It's from the 80s or something. This means war. From the 86? Some album, This Means War, with an exclamation mark. I hope you enjoy it, you musical Philistines. No, it's not Aerosmith, or whatever. It's John Schlitt and Petra. He's the newer lead singer of Petra. I'll be right back for the rest of Hour 2. Hang tight.
So manly.
This is my favorite song as a little kid. So nice. Thank you guys for bearing with me through the beautiful music. Those of you who stuck with me, press two if you left. Press one if you stayed. Before I get to Super Chats, let me get to Jaime in Minnesota, who's been on hold forever. Jaime in Minnesota, thank you for calling and holding through the break there. How you doing, man?
Pretty good. Hey, you remember a Fallen State episode with Judge Joe Brown?
Yeah, I do. Relatively recent, actually.
Yeah. I remember at the end there, the judge, he was talking about the O.J. Simpson trial, and he gave his opinion on it. Do you remember that?
No, I don't remember that.
Unless I dreamt it or, you know.
I think you. I think you might have. I vaguely remember something, but I don't remember any specifics.
Well, I don't want to give it away. Whoever is listening,
no.
I can go back.
That's an old one. So, well, I don't know if it's interesting. Let me know what he said.
It's very interesting. But what he said was that he looked at the file himself. You know, he looked at what the judges that judge looked at.
Yeah.
And his opinion on it was, he said what it was, but you want me to tell you what I think he said?
Yeah.
Oh, he said that it wasn't him. He didn't do it.
Wow.
You don't remember that?
It's very vague. It's very vague.
You got to go back and look at that, because I'm pretty sure that's what he said.
Okay. No,
I remember having to go back and listen to it twice because I was like, what?
Yeah. You know, was he, and I watched that episode premiere. That was relatively recent. That was just within like a year ago, I think. Is Judge Joe Brown still kicking?
He was going to be governor or mayor of a city.
Okay. Yeah.
But, 70, that made me think.
He's 76 as well. Now, Go ahead with your point.
No, go ahead.
He's black that you think was there anything in that that makes you think that Judge Joe Brown is thinking OJ's innocent because OJ and Judge Joe Brown are both black?
No, I don't think, no.
Okay.
The Judge Joe Brown seems like a good guy.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. But what he said was he looked at it,
whatever
the evidences were, and even the evidences that the jury weren't allowed to see.
Oh, yeah, because there's sometimes some exculpatory evidence, meaning
not just sometimes, it's like all the time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Isn't that so strange? Who makes those decisions? Is it the judge in the case that you can't?
From the movies that I watch, the lawyer movies I've seen. The two lawyers, they argue in front of the judge and say, this can't be put on or whatever. Is that true? I don't know. Maybe Joe can enlighten us on exculpatory evidences.
Yeah.
He's a lawyer, right?
Right. Or what? Or yeah, he's, yeah, yes.
Well, at least he'd have more information on that. I'd be interested to hear how that goes.
Because it's interesting that there's been some of these prominent Black Lives Matter cases, I feel like, have had stuff where you're not supposed to include information that's very telling about context.
Right.
They say, this is irrelevant. It might sway the jury too much. And I get that, but it just, anyway, it's wild.
And so, you know, in the news, especially with guys like Trump and Alex Jones, you know, we don't hear very much about it. We get some very surface level stuff, and then the juries, they hear more of it, but they don't get all of it. And
right.
then the, the only people that really know is the lawyers, maybe, and they don't know everything.
Yeah.
And then the judge, he sees all the evidence, but maybe he doesn't know everything either.
Yeah.
So, well, you know. But go look at that. And
okay. Nice. Yeah,
you know, Joe Brown said something.
Yeah, I wasn't keeping up with the case. I thought that everybody knew that when I was a younger man and a kid, my impression was that he was guilty and everybody knew he was guilty, but they just let him off for some reason. And I thought that it was because he was black and there were black jurors and stuff. But now I don't know, nor do I really care. Because, you know, it's over and done.
when I was more of an adult, I found out that the cops tried to frame him, and they got found out on that. And then that's also a reason why they said, you know, the cops tried to frame him, so forget it.
Oh. Hmm. Well, I don't know. There's all kinds of different motivations. Probably we would even guess wrong, you know? You know how when you see somebody do something and you think you know the motive? Or you see somebody do something, and that makes you think that they did something else, and that may not be the case. And you think they may know the reasoning, and the reasoning is totally different. Like, you really don't know what the truth is. It reminds me, yesterday or 2 days ago, there was a person in the live chat who posted something in the chat and then retracted that message. And everybody in the chat, a whole bunch of people in the chat thought, this, and then didn't respond again in that whole, during the whole show, maybe Nick's show or something, or Joelle Fridays. And then everybody in the chat was like, what happened? Some of the mods went rogue and blocked him. And in reality, the guy he just retracted a chat and he neglected to chat any further. And so people think that they know what's going on, but they're in their heads. They don't actually know.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you for the call. Jaime in Minnesota. Appreciate you, man.
Bye.
Bye. Some super chats, guys, on buymeacoffee.com/thehakereport. Carver bought one. Well, it looks like the tap water chickens. Got my tap water here and my The Hake Report, la la la, covering his ears monkey emoji mug. Well, it looks like the tap water chickens have finally come home to roost. Because I'm known for drinking tap water, okay? I got it from my mother. Because over in the, you know, the San Gabriel Valley, you can drink the tap water. Or at least you used to be able to. Tastes fine. The bottled water tastes weird. Filtered water tastes kind of weird. They are full of contaminated plastic gunk. Don't say gunk, kids, says Carver with his coffee. This could be an opportunity to prove to the average Joe from Phoenix that Hake can admit when he is wrong about things, but not so fast, Hake haters. The report came from the evil EPA about these forever chemicals in the tap water. The evil EPA is a corrupt, incompetent government agency. They turned a whole river orange one time. Remember that? Several years ago, 10 years ago? They turned the whole river orange. Some river. Orange. That doesn't seem right. It's kind of attractive, but it doesn't seem right. EPA. Are we really going to trust what they say? Sometimes they say factual things, just like the scared woman-led CDC. And Commie Nonsense Network. Are they the one magical, uniform, affirmative action-filled, non-agenda-driven, and reliable government organization? I think not. Using logic, either they are a bunch of liars, just like every other government body, or they are not, except for the CISA. Cybersecurity something something that said the election was the most secure in history. That government agency I trust 100% for the sake of my channel. They're a bunch of liars just like every other government body, or they are not lying and have been so incompetent and such a failure to allow this contamination over so long, and if so, we should have no confidence in them anyway. Yeah. Sounds to me like big bottled water. just wrote some campaign contribution checks. Keep tapping, Hake. Tapping. Thank you, Carver, with your coffee. Yeah, I read in Hake News that they're like BPAs or PFAS, P-F-A-S, some type of plastic that's in the water, and it's not good for you. They say you ingest a credit card's worth of plastic every week or month or year or something. I don't know. It's hearsay. Right on, Carver. I go for supposedly filtered water from the tap now. It's the filtered tap. They put in a filtered tap over here. But I also drink out of the drinking fountains at different parks and things. So that's one way you can get me. Anyway, another quick coffee from Popcorn's Thump Keg. Always like his coffees. I saw a clip yesterday of DJT, Donald J. Trump, our greatest president, visiting a Chick-fil-A location. Ooh, Chick-fil-A. He purchased 30 milkshakes and chicken sandwiches for the patrons in the restaurant. There are several headlines that could be written based on his visit, and they illustrate how easy it is to frame a situation, indeed, indeed, based on what side of the political spectrum on which you fall, the side on which you fall. Headline one, in Biden's economy, Trump treats cash-strapped Americans to a Chick-fil-A lunch. Headline two, with obesity on the rise, Trump buys unhealthy fast food for Chick-fil-A patrons. Are either one of those headlines quote-unquote wrong? I'm asking you, Hake, says Popcorn's Thump Keg. I don't know if those Chick-fil-A patrons are cash-strapped, maybe. So it might be wrong. In Biden's economy, Trump treats cash-strapped. Headline two, objectively, that is factual. It may be somewhat of a non sequitur, but I don't think it's a non sequitur. Obesity on the rise, Trump buys unhealthy fast food. I think it's supposed to be unhealthful. Unhealthy refers to a person or an animal, whether the animal is healthy or the person is healthy. The food is supposed to be healthful, I think. I think. I've gotten soft in my older age on that distinction. Healthful. Healthful food. It's healthful. H-E-A-L-T-T-H-F-U-L. I bet you somebody stopped listening to Hake because of this dumb rabbit trail tangent. Are either of one of those heads? It's interesting to me how this same event can be framed in many different ways. Yes. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed, Rooney. And you can bring up stuff that's irrelevant, too. Or you can do all kinds of things. Yep. Yeah. Nice. RIP. RIP. OJ Juice Simpson. Yeah, I agree with you, man. Rest in peace. I mean, it's not up to us, but we wish his soul well, whatever goes on, his spirit, something. Yeah, I was surprising to hear. He would always go on these video clips and say, "Hi, Twitter." I played a clip of it, and I disagreed with him on some stuff. But I've always kind of liked him. I'm not for murder or anything. And I don't know if he did that. So, whatever. Didn't matter. It's irrelevant. Wow, Richard in North Carolina is on the line. Richard, long time no here. How are you doing?
I'm okay. How about you?
I'm doing fine. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
All is well, right?
Yes.
So anyhow, you were mentioning the CDC, I heard you saying, and I want to let you know that after the big Fauci left, Mandy Cohan took over, which is kind of interesting because she was in North Carolina running. She was running the Department of Health and Human Services in North Carolina.
I didn't know that.
Illustrious Roy Cooper.
Mandy Cohen. Mandy Cohen. Cohen, yeah, Cohen. Was in yeah. charge. What did you call her, Foxy? Or you called the gal before her Foxy, the other unchristian gal before her Foxy?
It was Fauci, you know.
Oh, Fauci.
Fauci. Yeah, Fauci. Yeah.
But he wasn't in charge of the CDC either. It was another woman.
Rachel.
Rochelle.
Or something like that.
Forever Rochelle. Rochelle Walensky. And now it's Mandy Cohen, CDC.
Now it's Mandy Cohen. And the interesting about Mandy is that she doesn't even have a medical degree. She has a medical degree, but she's not licensed to see patients.
In
any state, I don't think. Definitely North Carolina. But she was running under Cooper, and Cooper forced her to resign because the COVID mess in North Carolina.
Whoa.
And if he wants to run for Senate, U.S. Senate ever, he could cover his butt because he could point his finger at Mandy and say, it's all her fault.
Wow.
That's why I asked for a resignation.
That's Democrat Governor Roy Cooper of North Carolina.
Roy Cooper, North Carolina. And Mandy started an illustrious career working in the White House under Obama. Does that surprise you?
No, yeah. It doesn't. She's the tender age of 45 years old. She's like my age. Interesting.
But am I surprised that she runs CDC? No. She's played her game of cards well.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
and that's what type of person does. They know how to play by the rules to get in.
But you can't believe someone that runs large agencies like that are not even licensed to see patients. Isn't that ridiculous?
Maybe. Yeah. It's important to be able to know how to run things. More important, I say, even than my impression. If you're going to run the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, I don't know if you need to be able to run patients, but you need to be able to run stuff effectively.
Well, I guess someone with a master's in public health probably could be the CDC director. That is true.
Yeah, I don't like this notion that judges and lawyers are supposed to have gone to law school and dumb stuff like that. And I mean, I get that it weeds out some things, but like...
But not in Washington, right? Not in Washington State anymore. Correct?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, good point. Because there's people with a better sense of actual justice and the law as it should be. Whereas the law as it should be. Hake just proved...
In California where you live, paralegals can do small claims court.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Yeah, isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Because there's so many cases. Because there's so much that the bar associations that they can't produce enough bar attorneys to handle small claims.
Wow. Interesting, man.
Well, California is the most litigious state next to New York when it comes to frivolous lawsuits.
Yeah. Now you say frivolous lawsuits. I agree with you that frivolous lawsuits. Are they classified as frivolous lawsuits by somebody, or are you saying that?
Well, the fact that their rate of dismissal, your state's DOJ has some of the worst, appeal rates on earth when stuff that they've sued upon have turned around, which they've given up on.
Nice.
I think it's like 60 or 70%.
Wow. So you're talking about the government being overly litigious. The government, state
too.
Government.
I'm just saying both.
Okay,
Hollywood, all that money. People sue.
Yeah.
Someone in Hollywood's got money, so they think they can, get money out of someone for something that happened over 30 years ago.
Somebody says, come on, man, says, Hake believes in pre-K only. I don't believe in pre-kindergarten, preschool. yes, you said commifornia. I agree with you, man.
Yeah.
It's California correct me if I'm wrong, but California used to be conservative.
Well, when my aunt moved out there in the 60s, California was beautiful. The beaches were great. It was the golden age, when most people, believed in common sense.
Yeah.
You know that?
Yep.
And she cared about their state, And then you know, Reagan left, and it was all downhill after Reagan left.
Was Reagan a Democrat when he was governor of California, or was he a Republican by that point?
No, he's a Democrat. Did he switch? He did switch parties.
Yeah, he was famous for saying, the Democrat Party left me. I didn't leave the Democrat Party.
Well, look what's going on now these days. All these people that are becoming independent.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had people in North Carolina state Senate become a super majority because we've had Democrats become Republicans over the abortion issue.
Oh, wow. Interesting. Yeah, I mean, you think the Democrat Party left you when you were Ronald Reagan times. The Democrats really run off the deep end now, and the rhinos are following them like dummies.
Well, I always say the inflation is not only Joe Biden's fault, but it's also the consent of the rhinos that are in the House and the Senate.
You know, I totally agree with you. Like, I talked with Joe in Phoenix at the beginning of my show today, and he told me about these Obamaphones, and he traced it all the way back to Reagan. And before that, I think he had told me it was a Bush, one of the Bush presidents who was doing it. Yeah, and so I don't know what the truth is. I don't really care, but yeah, I agree with you. The rhinos, the establishment Republican Party, they're evil too. They just pretend like they're for what's right.
Not to be pro-Democrat, because I'm not.
Yeah.
Isn't it funny that Bill Clinton, Slick Willie, actually balanced the budget?
Yeah, that's what I heard. I remember I was in high school, and I started to discover that people around me were liberals and supported, like, Democrats. And I was like, oh, Clinton was a bad president.
Liberal was different back there. It was actually liberal. It wasn't leftist. Now it's leftist.
Right. Yeah. But Clinton, my parents or whoever was telling me about politics back then, which wasn't much, but I would overhear him being called a liar, which that proved to be true, and a chameleon, a political chameleon, meaning he would just...
Well, he's a sociopath.
He would go along with whatever he needed to do to stay in power.
Well, he's a narcissistic sociopath.
You said balance the budget. Before I get into this sociopath stuff, he balanced the budget. Is that because of the Republicans who were in power at the time forcing him to do that?
Newt Gingrich forced his hand because they had a majority.
And so was it Gingrich? So do we thank Gingrich was kind of a rhino too, but do we thank Gingrich for forcing Clinton to balance the budget, or was it Clinton's doing?
I think it was a combination of you know, you want to look good, right, Bill?
Yeah.
And Newt said the bill, and Bill said, yeah, you want to look good? And Newt said, yeah, sure. Let's do this.
Okay.
It's never about the American people. It's always about how they can either pad their pocket or get it reelected.
Yeah, indeed. He don't really care. He's just winning his election.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think that's from a song or a rap song or something.
Yeah.
He don't really mean it. He's just winning his election. Anyway.
Well, they also did the welfare to work.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
They're forcing the blacks and the lazy whites who were on welfare to be able to get welfare. You have to actually get a job or actually actively apply for a job.
Yeah, that's great. So what do you mean by sociopath, real quick?
Well, you look at how Billy is. I mean, Bill was, I did not have sex with that woman.
Right.
I mean, you look at his eyes, and his eyes are vacant, you know, when he says that. And vacancy in an eye is one of the telltale signs of a sociopathic, you know, likelihood. Because, you know, there's three tiers of social pathology, right, you have to meet. You have to be egotistic, extreme egotistic, not care about what happens to anybody.
I remember.
And I'm trying to remember.
You say egotistic. Let me cut in. I remember him like sticking his chin in the air, and he was kind of chubby. Yeah. He was kind of chubby back then, all like proud of himself, like with a smirk on his face. I'm like, this guy.
He knew what happened.
Interesting. Well, I remember him doing that just in general, just in like speeches. I'm talking about before the whole Monica Lewinsky scandal thing. I'm talking about just in general. He would just stick his chin up in the air.
On Saturday Night Live with David Letterman, or with David Letterman. You mean when he did the sat, when he was with the sunglasses on and beating his ego? You know,
okay,
seeing what Satan was telling him.
So vacant eyes. That sounds sort of subjective. How can you tell what somebody's eyes are vacant?
Well, it's just he just when he tells a lie.
I did not.
It's just second nature to him. And usually when people
like
lie, their eyes, you know, move, you know, to certain parts
because they're
trying to think up a lie.
Yeah,
a
like nervous
is so
or bug-eyed. So okay, go ahead.
Yeah, it's so normal for sociopaths because they have no moral conscience.
Uh huh.
And the third tier of social pathology is having people there's no way that guy could do that, you know, that he's a really nice guy, everybody loves him.
Oh,
but he'll
okay.
backstab you in a heartbeat if he thinks he'll further his and he can get away with it.
So that's charm.
Yeah, charm.
Okay.
I absolutely hate sociopaths.
Wow, you shouldn't hate them.
I don't hate them, but if I feel anybody has any tendency of social pathology, I avoid them.
Oh, that's fair. That's wise, probably.
I mean, I pray the best. I hope the best for them, and I move on.
Okay.
And I cut them off.
Yeah. Interesting, man. Well, thank you for the little education there.
All right, hey.
Appreciate
you,
man. All right.
See you later.
Bye. I'm chuckling because somebody said, Skydog Pigpen says, the vacant eye... is BS, bogus speech. Don't say BS, kids, even though it just means bogus speech. Artie Art from Ohio is on the line here. Art, thank you for calling and holding there, man. How you doing?
I'm all right. Hey, how you doing?
Doing fine. Thank you.
Well, this is the piggyback off of what the last caller was talking about with the eyes. To where, you know, I get what he's saying. I agree with what he's saying about the eyes or whatnot. This being, you can tell when somebody's lying or whatnot, and how Bill Clinton might have been looking when he was talking, to where you would be like, oh, he lies so much that you can't even tell.
Yeah.
And, I mean, just look at Nancy Pelosi. Let's look at Maxine Waters. Let's look at... with the Letitia James prosecutor in New York.
Oh yeah.
Look at the mayor in Chicago. I mean,
which one? Which mayor in Chicago? The lesbian ex mayor or this new guy, Brandon Johnson?
Not Beetlejuice.
Oh,
no,
okay.
You know, she gone.
Yeah.
My Brandon Johnson.
Okay.
Cool. That's Cool Breeze. Brandon Johnson. Cool Breeze. Cool Breeze. Brandon Johnson. You can like some of the stuff when he be saying some of the stuff he be saying. You can look in his eyes and tell that he don't believe what he's saying.
Wow, really?
I mean, I do. I can look in his eyes and tell he don't believe. I when I look in his eyes, his eyes tell me. Basically, he gives me the. He make me feel, or he when I see his eyes, it makes me think that it's like you liberals, y'all pushing me to say this or whatnot. But I know that the people ain't believing this and. I wonder how long this is going to last before they throw me out of office or something. That's what I get when I see from his eyes. I get that he knows that we know he's lying, and how he basically saying how long is this nonsense going to keep going on, basically. We're going to keep allowing this nonsense to go on because I don't be believing him.
How do you know? How do you know that this is not all in your imagination about what he's thinking?
Well, I mean, I don't think that this is in my imagination. I mean, just what he be saying and some of the stuff that he be saying or whatnot, it just doesn't make sense. And I think that he knows that we know it don't make no sense. Just like I give you a prime example. Was this a shooting or whatnot? Or whatnot, and I guess they up there riding in Chicago
Brandon,
right now. And
he
made a little press conference, and he was saying, well, I got black boys and this and this and this and this and that. And you look at it, if you look at his eyes or whatnot, and you think about, I mean, all right, let's just go off with, what do you have, let me go off what I'm thinking. What do you have to, having black kids have to do with a criminal doing something criminal and getting himself shot? So going off of his eyes or whatnot, and, you know, just looking at his eyes, when he's saying what he's saying, I know he know that I can't believe, I know he knows that when he's saying this stuff, people like me don't believe nothing that he's saying. This ain't got nothing to do with no black boys.
Right.
This got to do with parenting and right and wrong. That's what I'm saying.
You know, the case that you're referring to is this Dexter Reed fellow, who was a 26-year-old mm-hmm. young black man who I heard a little bit, I think, on the Jason Lee Peterson show in the maybe the third hour today, talking about his, with a clip of his mother saying, he just got a new car and he was just doing his thing. But he fired up, allegedly he fired at the police.
Yeah.
Escalated it right away for some reason. And then they shot him dead. And he wounded an officer, according to CBS News or whatever report that I read. If that's true, you're right. It has nothing to do with being black, except for that so many blacks are told this about the cops, that the cops are profiling them and being quote-unquote racist, as if that justifies them. That encourages them to go even more out of control, which is the opposite of what they should be doing. They should be doing, like, the cops are your best friends. So.
Yeah.
Wow.
And just another.
So you're saying that Brandon Johnson went out there? According to you, you're saying Brandon Johnson went out there and said, oh, I have black boys. And
yeah.
So he's kissing up to these blacks who are pretending that this is about being black and racism.
Yeah.
I'm shaking
and
my
not
head.
Only that, yeah, and not only that, just even when it's... Even let's go off the eye scenario again or whatnot. Yeah. He also said that he went and visited the black dude's family or whatnot, and, you know, basically gave his condolences. And my thing is this: why are you going and seeing a criminal, somebody that would shot at the cops or went on a traffic stop, and then come to find out one of the cops was allegedly shot in the arm? So, what do you think that the cops are feeling that you don't went and visit a person's family that shot at us, and the cops are really the victim in this situation? One of the cops are really the victim in this situation.
Right.
And just like I was saying about the odds when he was sitting here saying it, I'm thinking this the whole time, like, you basically undermining your police force, then you wonder why the police don't want to come work for you and want to be police officers in Chicago, Illinois, because you got lame brains like this. And I'm looking at his eyes, and I know he's knowing that this is going to affect the morality of the police and how they trust you as the mayor. And I'm looking at his eyes, and I'm telling this. You can tell he's thinking this, but he doesn't have no control because he's a liberal, and this is the agenda they're pushing. So I might be wrong with what his eyes might be saying, but that's the whole thing that I'm thinking when I say, I just know that it looks like he don't believe this, the BS that he's pushing out of his mouth.
He may not. I mean, he may well not.
And I feel like he's being forced to, like, be on this left. Oh, let me go visit the criminal that shot at the cops and while one of my officers was shot.
Well, one of the signs of being a liberal is caving to peer pressure. If that's what's really going on, if Brandon Johnson is not a true believer in his own lies or in the lies that have been pushed for these generations, then he is still a liberal because he's weak, and that's why I say that most Republicans are liberals too, you know, and most of us conservatives and Christians, if we're subject to pressure, can't handle pressure, whether it's peer pressure or political pressure or public shame or whatever else, that is a sign of being a weak liberal within your deep down within your heart. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Man, well, interesting. I appreciate that. Though that's some nice context that you're given in light of what he's saying.
And there's some, like, it ain't that I know what he's thinking.
Right.
It's just I can I know that you know that I know that you full of BS. That's what I'm saying.
So,
you know, I ain't trying to be no mind reader. You know when somebody's BSing you, Hake. You,
yeah.
Whether you think that you can read their mind or not, you know when by their body language, how they move and how they talk and how they look.
Yep. Bogus speech.
Okay, let me leave. Bogus speech. Okay, just real quick, real quick.
Okay.
Okay, so you was talking about the ladies getting punched in the face in New York.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay. Well, I mean, once again, this is what you voted for. We're not in, and plus these cities, that cities are supposed to be, or Democrats set these cities up to be liberal jungles or whatnot, hell hoes.
Yeah.
So if you a female that looks like her, or any other female that lives in New York, this is part of the of what is supposed to be happening in these liberal cities. It's only if you can keep it under control. And what Democrats and liberals ain't able to do is keep it at a minimum. What they are doing, they're escalating the stuff that's going on by the policies that they're pushing.
Right.
But I mean, think about that, man. Are we getting like people news time on CNN and News Network for somebody getting punched in the eye? I mean,
I know. That's wild.
You know what I mean?
Those are relatively minor offenses, aren't they?
Petty.
Yeah.
Okay. Did you hear about the allegedly the LGBT dudes or whatnot? It was a group of them. Just like you said, don't be the last one walking in behind the crowd. Because what you say? You said the last one is the weakest link or something like that. You were saying.
Yep. The straggler. Yep.
The straggler.
Yep. They're the vulnerable and unsuspecting.
Okay, well, it was a dude, he had, I guess, a Rolex watch on, so some of these migrants that, you know, these liberal, woke females and these liberal Brandon Johnson-type beta dudes voted for, when these little migrants rode up on these bikes or whatnot, them little motor scooters they have over there in shithole Venezuela and all these other
sorry, kids.
Shithole countries, excuse my language, and basically just told the dude in broken English to come up off of that Rolex or whatnot, and I just wanted to go to say that that's what y'all voted for, and it's going to be a lot more of that type of stuff in a big city like New York,
yeah.
To where they're going to be taking y'all's stuff and sending it back to their country, coming over here taking y'all's jobs or whatnot, sending it back to the country, and basically robbing America. But I ain't going to hold you too much longer.
I appreciate it, Art. It's good to hear from you again, man. Take care.
Catch you later, Hank.
Bye. You know, talking to Art from Ohio just now, he brought up this crime that's been going on, and there was a crime that I thought of. Oh yeah, he brought up this person who was wearing a Rolex, and he was robbed, and it reminded me of a case of a black young like rapper who was hanging around with his girlfriend at like Roscoe's Chicken and Waffles or some place like that, maybe Popeyes, down in like one of the worst ones that you can go to. And his girlfriend posted a picture. Oh, you know, like a lot of rappers are showy about their swag, their stuff that they have, their jewelry and cash. And they post pictures of it on the internet, on IG, Instagram, and maybe TikTok and places like that, showing off, which is very unwise. And then even more unwise, or equally unwise, the girlfriend posting a picture, oh, we're in checking in at Popeyes or Roscoe's Chicken and Waffles or wherever. And they robbed the dude, or came to rob him, or just came to shoot him. They shot him dead or something. This happened like a year or two ago or less, maybe several months only. Remember that story? I talked about it on the maybe in Hake News, on the JLP show, and maybe in the Hake Report. For one, don't be showing off that stuff. You're not even supposed... That's all feeding the ego like crazy. It's just, look at me, look at what I have. Dumb. And then on top of that, your girlfriend out of control. Yeah, and he was robbed by black men in Roscoe's, says Tim Scott. Yeah, that's what I'm guessing too, fellow blacks. Why wear some thick chain? And what's the temptation of robbing? everybody got their issues. I don't relate to the temptation of the LGBT stuff. I don't relate to the temptation of the stealing, at least not on that level, and punching. Everybody has their issues. Shout out to the thieves and those messy people. Not judging. It's just that it's done. It's just interesting what people, the crazy things that people get into, crazy as in evil, things that people get into, and also meaning crazy. Yeah, it's wild. Huh. That's what I say to it. Huh. Shaking my head. Let me just, oh, super chats, a Streamlabs flurry from Lin Yen Chin. Lord Goodhair, I realize your species, British, with two T's, he spells it, culled away your more caveman type genome in the Middle Age era where England murders all her most violent criminals. Is it murder? Maybe. Producing a eugenic effect that distilled your bloodlines into the more docile mode. Hake could be described as docile. Lin Yenshin continues, to revive your lost gene expression, or even a hybrid, vigor-optimized state between your weak state versus caveman state, cultivate your sense of proportion. What do you mean, like bulk up, you mean? Is that what you mean? Or sense of proportion. There, I have given away the key to use of intent, aka desire, or willpower for gene editing. You can change your genes through willpower, he's telling me. Stimulating proprioception is your sense of so-called time plus so-called space as one item you incorrectly call two different things that have no relation unless we say so, because mouth breathers create and God was created by us. Note, I use nose. Lin Yenshin breathes through his nose. The mouth is not for breathing. You can use it to rapidly exhale, but never to inhale. Be it a gasp of shock, or in hyping up with excitement, your wide mouth face experience on getting a thrill. Refine proprioception. I'll have to look what that is. To see beyond deception. Interesting. Yeah, kind of like how Artie Art has a spidey sense of knowing when a Brandon Johnson is lying. Proprioception define. Perception or awareness of the position and movement of the body. Nice. Hey. Okay. That's cool. He would chide me on spinal alignment sometimes too. Thank you, man. He also says, Lord Goodhair, Jesse will pretend not to understand this, but do tell him on air. Say, sin means error and DNA replicas through error. So we are all born in sin of DNA's failure to be perfect, a.k.a. unchanged. It really is that simple. Thank you, Lin Yen Chin. Appreciate those supers, man. And because I know you're a boomer like me, but come on over to buy me a coffee. If you so please, but you don't have to. Or you can do Ko-fi, K-O-F-I, coffee, K-O-F-I.com. Oh, let's see. / the Hake Report. Nice. Aman is out of India, and I have like a minute to go. Aman, am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Yes, you're right.
Hey, go ahead. We have a very short time. Let's get right to it.
Okay, so I had a quick question. Sean, coming me to you. I've heard Jesse say, endure, endure, endure. And in the end, prize is yours. What is the prize? Is there any specific, like, anything mentioned in the Bible?
Oh, well, maybe the kingdom of heaven? I don't know. I think that the Bible does talk about he who endures to the end will be saved, run the race in such a way as to win the prize, heavenward in Christ Jesus. Now I'm quoting a song. Man, I don't know off the top of my head what the prize is, what prize it is.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, like, yeah, I don't know. I have no, I can't even tell you.
It's okay.
But it's an interesting,
I'll
it's a good question. Oh, you'll ask him tomorrow. Sounds good.
Yeah, if he doesn't answer, I'll call you then.
Sounds good. That'll be my homework to look it up.
Yep, smoke on it.
Sounds good, man. Appreciate you.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, take care. Guys, this has been the Hake Report. I got to end on time. It's Torah, Torah, Torrance. Thursday. Hat tip to Kevin Howe, you pagan. And this track is entitled My Turn in the Hot Seat. I hope you enjoy it, you musical Philistines. It's from the album Get Into It from the year like 2001 or something, or two or three. Well, adios, America. Joel Friday TV coming up next. Bye. Some of you guys might not like it that much. Check out my flat earth. You guys ever been to Torrance? Beautiful area. Maybe not. Reminds me of the bratty vocals of Oasis. Remember Oasis? Nah, it's good. Is this a joke, man? Singer struggles with allergies. What a vibe, huh? It's from Lujo Records, L-U-J-O, I think. Music isn't bad, but hey, shut that boy up. Putting it off. I like his bratty vocals. Soy FM. This guy still plays horrible music during the break. Scary, huh? Ooh, okay. It's an El Nino spider. I didn't see those spiders until El Nino. I gotta get out of here. Joel Friday coming up next. Adios, America. Bye.